Is it on now? Can you hear me? Yeah. You can hear me now, Christian. Yeah. I just have to shout loud then. So welcome everyone to this lecture, DS lecture today. We have Peter Krustrup, full professor at the Sport and Health Department. So it's a great pleasure for me, Peter, to welcome you here. You became DS chair just 1 year ago. So this is sort of your introductory lecture to DS and to everyone here and also with us online. So Peter, you got your PhD from Copenhagen University, and then you have been at Exeter. You have actually written a little bit on your biography up here. You were at the University of Exeter for 3 years, and then you came here at SDU in 2016 as a full professor. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yes. And yeah, I mean, you have an amazing career behind you. I realized that you started playing football. Is it okay to say football or is it soccer? Yeah.
Football.
Football. Fine. Yes, already as 5 years old. Mm-hmm. So and then you've been on to it ever since, and have a career actually in football, being coach and also expert in many ways. Use as an expert in football. And then you turned it into your research area, so I believe you are maybe one of the first ones that actually got a career in football science, and you are now one of the world leading scientists in the field. So it's amazing. I think you have around 335 research papers, and 165 of those deals with football and other sports. So so that is amazing. You have, and I think you will talk much more about that, so I will not mention that, but you have developed this international football is medicine platform from 2018, and I know that is something that really is to your heart and you want to make that recognized all over the world. And I must admit also, every time I hear a talk by you, I'm getting closer to football, you know. You have almost convinced me that that should be my next sport that I should enjoy. The last thing I just want to mention, Peter, is the last award that I know that you got, and you got it here from SDU. So you got the SDU award for research communication. This is very amazing, and I think all of you here present today will also learn a little bit about your skills in communication or outreach. So welcome, Peter, and I'm looking very much forward to your talk.
Thank you so much, Marianne. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today as DS chair, a newcomer in DS, but not a newcomer in science. I'm happy to represent the Department of Sports Science and Clinical Biomechanics, and I'm happy to represent my research group, Sport and Health Sciences. And as you can see from the title, I would like to cover a lot of aspects in just 50 minutes, so be prepared. I would like to cover the use of sports in relation to improving public health, and I would like to talk also about how to boost performance of elite athletes with a specific focus on women's football. And I would like to, as this is a DS lecture where a broad scientific background and a lot of collaboration between different backgrounds and research backgrounds, it's very important for me to talk about translational research all the way from muscle to man or woman, and all the way from lab to society. And I would like to start up with just a 1 minute video that the SDU produced for me when I received the Research Dissemination Award, which kind of adds to what Marianne already told you.
Årets modtager for formidlingsprisen er professor i sport og sundhed, Peter Krustrup fra Institut for Idræt og Biomekanik.
Jeg er glad og meget stolt over, at min formidling bliver værdsat, og at vi som idrætsforskere bliver anerkendt for den impact, vi har på folkesundheden og på danske sportspræstationer.
Peter er en engageret dygtig formidler af forskning på både de helt små og de allerstørste scener. De danske landshold i fodbold og håndbold har eksempelvis stor gavn af hans forskning og formidling, men også skoler og idrætsforeninger nyder godt af hans viden. For eksempel har han udviklet de sundhedsfremmende koncepter som 11 for Health, Fit First, Fodbold Fitness. De bruges i dag af mere end 50.000 danskere, og de er introduceret i 22 lande. Peter Krustrup står også bag den internationale platform Football is Medicine. Platformen engagerer 225 forskere, der verden over udbreder den nyeste viden om sport som sundhedsfremme. Derfor er Peter den helt rigtige modtager prisen som årets forskningsformidler på SDU 2021.
For mig er forskningsformidling og interaktion med omverdenen ligesom afleveringer i fodboldspillet. Det er utrolig vigtigt for, at ens forskning bliver forstået og brugt. Og for os har det været helt afgørende for, at vi er kommet i mål med, at vores evidensbaserede motionskoncepter har opnået så stor udbredelse, som de har. Thanks a lot. And when I'm talking about our evidence-based concepts, it's very important for me to praise my research group. Many of you are here today. And this is a fantastic team, both in terms of investigating elite performance, but also health effects of football and other sports for children and adults and elderly and patients. So thanks a lot. These are my three main research areas, covering both the elite sports, the health effects of football and other sports, and then exercise physiology. And the exercise physiology part is actually very important in terms of using the same methodologies and using the same approaches and research designs into the field studies. And that is a very important part, and I would like to show you some of the areas that we have been covering and that we are interested in exploring further in the coming years. And interestingly, many of the methodologies that we've been using in elite football has also been used in recreational sports. So when investigating the Premier League or the Serie A or the World Cup, we are using advanced technology in terms of movement pattern, but those same methodologies can actually be applied to patients. And it's extremely important to be able to measure the loading during exercise for patients, because that describes some of the mechanisms behind the adaptation seen for other research groups. Okay, this is where it started some 25 years ago at the University of Copenhagen in collaboration with Professor Magni Moore, who is here today, investigating metabolism, investigating efficiency, and investigating muscle fiber recruitment. And those methodologies and the knowledge that we've gained from using those technologies and methodologies are very important in terms of transferring this research to the practical field and understanding why the best players in the world actually are improved with certain types of training. And for many years we have investigated different types of exercise, different types of training in the lab, and used some of those technologies shown here with muscle biopsies, blood sampling, also in training studies, and obviously a lot of health-related measurements, DEXA scanning, blood pressure measurements, echocardiography. Later on, we moved closer to the field, to the football fields, to the handball halls. And as you can see, it's also possible to take muscle biopsies in Qatar or in Greece or in Germany or in Denmark, in Odense, And you can see that some of the beds are prepared for the players. So after an intense exercise, they are invited to come to the bed for a muscle biopsy and a blood sample. And we've been doing that for many years and in many different places around the world. And last but not least, after gaining all this evidence, after conducting all this research, it's very important for me and for my research group to translate that into evidence-based concepts related to healthy activities for children and adults and elderly and patients, but also testing procedures or training protocols for elite athletes. And the first part of my talk will be about the use of sports for health, and that will cover untrained adults between 15 and 99 years of age. That will cover socially deprived homeless men. There's a documentary going on right now on DR1 about this special population and how they can benefit from football. I would also like to touch briefly upon the effects of football for patients with pre-diabetes, type 2 diabetes, high blood pressure, osteopenia, and some types of cancer. And last but not least, in this first round, first half, we could call it, I would like to talk about sport for school children related to our programs, Fit First and 11 for Health. Before I start that first part, it's very important for me that we stand on strong shoulders. That's a very strong Scandinavian tradition in exercise physiology and using the physical activity and sports for health, both at the University of Southern Denmark, but also at the University of Copenhagen. And here I'm quoting Bente Klarlund Petersen and Bengt Saltin for providing evidence in a very well-known review on physical activity as a cornerstone in the prevention and treatment of lifestyle diseases. And Rob Sallis, he said things a little clearer. Exercise is medicine, and physicians need to prescribe it. And in 2012, Kaim Khan, who was the editor-in-chief of British Journal of Sports Medicine, said, sport seems to contribute to the health of nations. And we have more evidence now, 9 years later. If we talk about the timeline for my work in sport and health, I started out with pilot studies, 2003, with homeless men, with untrained old boys players in Denmark, and also FC Zulu. You may even know the Zulu team. They had a revival last year. I was also involved in that. And later on, we started out with randomized controlled trials, started out with untrained adults, then moved on to patients and children. And then we collaborated with close collaborators around the globe to look at international studies and then large-scale studies. That has resulted in 150 papers until now from our group related to football for health and sport for health. And I have a Christmas present for you. One of the special issues that have been published in relation to this. This was the third special issue. We started out with football as prevention, 2010, then football as treatment, 2014. And then we moved on to football is medicine, because we found that we had enough evidence to provide that strong statement. That was in 2018 with the Momse team, the Danish soccer grannies on the front page. I will show a brief video soon about this team from my hometown. And we've also released special issues on ball games as prevention, team handball, basketball, and other team sports. We've published several books on this theme, Ball Games for Life and also Football as Medicine, with 75 contributing authors from around the globe. Last but not least, it's very important to talk about how to make a large-scale implementation. And for that, we have had a huge collaboration worldwide and also very strong collaboration with Danish stakeholders, the sporting organizations and the charities and funding bodies in order to use the scientific evidence for programs, evidence-based programs, and also importantly to conduct coaching courses to disseminate the research findings, but also disseminate the program as such to schools, municipalities, and football clubs. Okay, let's look at some results. This is from a review from 2010, comparing four very popular types of sports: football, long distance running, called jogging in this article, strength training, and interval running. And as you can see here, I've split it into the cardiovascular fitness, the metabolic fitness, and the musculoskeletal fitness. And perhaps you can see it from where you sit, that football combines high intensity training, which is also often called HIIT, high intensity interval training. It combines endurance training and strength training at the same time. And that makes football a multi-component sport. You can get all the same benefits from entering the fitness center if you go to the rowing ergometer and do interval training, then you go to the bicycle and do endurance training, and then you go to the machines to do your strength training, and you can get all three types of training, but you can also do that by entering the football pitch, playing small-sided football. And on top of that, a close collaboration with sports psychologists led us to ask how hard it felt, how hard the players felt and the participants felt doing their sports. And the interval runner said, this is really hard, 7 on a scale from 0 to 10, whereas the joggers and the strength training participants said it was moderately hard, 6 out of 10, whereas the football players, even though they had very high heart rates and performed a lot of high intensity action, they said it was quite easy to do high intensity exercise. And that's really interesting. If you want to make people come back to do very strenuous exercise, then it's a very good idea, obviously, to do it with your friends and to do it in a joyful manner where you focus on something else than the strenuous part of the exercise. We, Morten Ranners and others, and I, looked into the fitness and health effects for homeless men playing football. And these are photos from the national team. We've also conducted research on some of the participants in the Copenhagen shelters. And as you can see here, football is also very joyful for them, but also a broad spectrum training that improves the VO2 max. So it improves cardiovascular fitness. It improves metabolic fitness. Here we see results from lowering of LDL cholesterol. And at the same time, it's very good musculoskeletal training. As you can see here, there are big improvements in the postural balance. And combined with big improvements in muscle strength and bone mineralization, this is actually really good to try to prevent falls and fractures. And you may not know it, but these participants, they are hospitalized 5 times more often than the general population with sudden trauma. And that's related to several things. Of course, misuse of drugs and alcohol, but also a poor fitness and improvements of postural balance. The ability to have a rapid muscle force may avoid some of the falls. And if they fall, stronger bones may actually prevent fractures. This is the football fitness concept, really, really popular in Denmark and on the Faroe Islands and in many, many other countries around the globe. Training without games, no competitive games against local rivals. Everybody are included, everybody are in the team, always. And it's not a matter of being skillful, it's just a matter of enjoying being active. And just by doing that, we see very large and systematic increases in VO2 max, an average of 15%, and 3.5 milliliters per minute per kilogram in VO2 max. And with very high improvements also for those that have never been on the football pitch before. So Marianne, please take up football. There are huge improvements to gain from this. And what about the bones? Actually, just after 14 weeks of training, we saw a 2.5% increase in bone mineralization in the tibia. This is with a three-dimensional scan of the lower leg. That is actually corresponding to 2 to 5 years younger bones. Just in 14 weeks, that's a good investment. What about the increases in VO2 max? That actually corresponds to a very big lowering of the risk of cardiovascular disease. Around 40% decrease in the risk of cardiovascular disease after only 3 to 6 months of training. And can everybody play? Yes, indeed. This is a video from my hometown.
Professor Peter Krustrup har i samarbejde med DBU skabt Fodbold Fitness, en træningsform, der kan tilgås af mænd og kvinder i alle aldre. Her tæt på jul er to hold mænd og kvinder i aldersgruppen 60-80 år i fuld gang på de udendørs baner i Frederikssund Idrætsklub.
Vores forskning viser, at fodboldtræning på små baner uden kampe, det er meget effektivt til at forebygge livsstilssygdomme, både knogleskørhed og forhøjet blodtryk og type 2 diabetes. Det er en intens og varieret træning. Pulsen den er høj. Og så er der mange momenter i træningen, både når man dribler, afleverer og skyder, som gør, at man får god belastning for musklerne og knoglerne. Det gør, at man får bedre balance. Og tilsammen så er den her træning, udover den er sjov og social, så er det faktisk meget effektivt til at forebygge fald og knoglebrud for ældre kvinder.
Jeg har læst, man har godt af det, og jeg har altid dyrket gymnastik. Jeg har 2 undervisningstimer om ugen på et ældrecenter i gymnastik. Og så har jeg cyklet om onsdagen, og da jeg holdt op med det, så begyndte jeg at spille fodbold, fordi Åse kom ned på ældrecenter og spurgte, om der var nogen, der ville være med.
Jeg så et indslag i Godaften Danmark, hvor der sad 2 ældre herrer og fortalte om, at de spillede på FC Prostate holdet, og de talte rigtig meget om, hvor godt det var. Og det var godt for prostata, det var godt for diabetes, og det var godt for højt blodtryk. Og der havde jeg lige en udfordring med noget for højt blodtryk, og faktisk lige begyndte at tage noget medicin for det. Og jeg tror, jeg fik alle de bivirkninger, man overhovedet kunne få på de piller der. Og så sad jeg en aften foran Godaften Danmark og så, jamen så er det jo fodbold, jeg skal spille.
Fodbold Fitness er jo kreeret til at passe til både utrænede og ældre. Det er med hovedfokus på en god, grundig opvarmning, og så altså spil med venner. Og når man organiserer fodbold på den måde, så er der relativt få skader.
Det er forbudt at stå på bolden. Det er forbudt at træde op på bolden og komme til at stå der, fordi du kan så let få en fibersprængning.
Vi kan se meget markante effekter af 3x40 minutters fodbold i skoleregi for piger på 8-12 år. Og vi kan se meget markante effekter af regelmæssig fodboldfitness for kvinder, både før overgangsalderen og efter overgangsalderen. Det gavner samfundet på rigtig mange forskellige måder. Osteoporoseforeningen har lige gjort op, at man bruger 11 milliarder på behandling.
Meget godt mål, ikke? That was a good goal. This team, the Danish Soccer Grannies, are actually world famous now. We started out with 6 players 5 years ago. Now there are 75 players. And we call this the world's oldest football team. Because with 75 players, with an average age of more than 70, this is actually more than 5,000 living years. And just a normal national team, like the Danish male national team, they just have like 500 living years. So they are very unexperienced compared to this team. And they've been on the front page in many newspapers, also in a Chinese newspaper. Soccer grannies play for extra time. And we had a Chinese television company visiting us in Frederick some time ago. And that adds to many, many news stories from around the globe, because health interest the world and football interests the world. So that's a really, really strong combination. And we've had many headlines also in American and British television companies. Burn it like Beckham, that's an old one. And soccer, a great way to kick high blood pressure. And then the New York Times, also some years ago, said soccer moms should not stay outside just serving coffee and fruit for their children. They should enter the pitch. That's a quite strong message. Some of the other concepts that we've been looking at, FC Prostate was also mentioned, has some strong results backing up the concept. Likewise for Football for the Heart, which is now promoted in 24 municipalities in Denmark. Football for the Heart builds on many results related to heart health, but also many results related to the effects as hypertensive medication. So football can be used as medicine against hypertension. And as you can see here, results for different groups, hypertensive men, hypertensive women, and type 2 diabetic men shows that there's an average decline in blood pressure of around 10 millimeters of mercury after just 3 to 6 months of training, which is quite similar to what you get from taking pills against hypertension. And obviously, if you have very high blood pressure, you have to combine the two. FC Prostate is also a nationwide program running in Denmark with men between 55 and 80 being treated against prostate cancer with anti-androgen treatment, blocking their testosterone. And they have a lot of side effects if they do not play football. And some of these are shown here. You can actually get an increase in muscle mass, even though you don't have any testosterone, if you play football. And it's very systematic. Likewise, you can have stronger bones if you combine the medication with football. If you do nothing, if you're passive, then you will have a lowering of bone mineralization in many different sites, as you can see here. But if you play football, you can actually avoid that negative side effect. And here we've been looking at a long-term follow-up 5 years after we started. And even though the subjects were 5 years older and had received treatment for 5 years, they still had stronger bones compared to when they started. And you see some of the participants out here. And a study from 2019 investigated the nationwide implementation with a one-year study randomized controlled trial with a 50-50 split between the intervention group with football and the control group. And in that case, we showed that there's an improved mental health score after 1 year of football training, but also 40% less hospital admissions, which is a quite important argument for the public health sector. And when summing all these randomized control trials up. We have been able to do some meta-analysis, and some of the results are described here. A huge positive effect of football training, 3 to 6 months of training. In this case, only 3 to 4 months of training, improving maximal oxygen uptake by 3.5. And in another meta-analysis from 2019, we looked into the effects, the broad spectrum health effects, including a high effect on blood pressure, but also fat percentage and LDL cholesterol. Now just a few comments on sport for school children. We have two programs running in the Danish municipality, Fit First 10, Fit First 20. And also Living for Health. Focusing on small-sided exercises and games that are intense, but also motivating and involving, and with social elements. And here you can see that Fit First 10 encompasses 10 different sports, which are all modified to fit these criteria. And that program is being used for 6 to 10 years old. And another program, Fit First 10, which is done in collaboration with 20 different sports, is being used for 10 to 12 year olds. And in our group, we are now working with a Fit First Teen and also a Fit First Youth that can be used for older children. And just a short video about the
FIFA 11 for Health, det er sundhedsundervisning på fodboldbanen, hvor børnene de har det sjovt, for god træning og lærer en hel masse. Både de, der er vant til at spille fodbold, og de, som ikke spiller fodbold i en fodboldklub.
Meget fint, flot samarbejde.
Den europæiske version af FIFA 11 for Health, som jeg har været med til at udvikle sammen med FIFAs forskningsenhed FMARC og DBU, den har faktisk vist sig både at have effekter på børnenes fysiske form, deres blodtryk og fedtprocent, men også deres sociale trivsel og deres sundhedsviden om fysisk aktivitet, om kost, om hygiejne, og så det at samarbejde og tænke positivt.
Forløbet er jo bygget så.
Godt. And after studying those concepts and conducting pilot studies and afterwards modifying the programs and then studying them again, we can now conclude that there are huge positive broad spectrum effects of both programs, the Fit First 10, which certainly improves heart health and bone health. It improves physical fitness and it improves blood pressure. And the 11 for Health is even broader in terms of the outcomes, because it combines health education with a lot of focus on well-being, on diet, on physical activity, and therefore it provides, after only 11 weeks, 2 times 45 minutes per week, it improves well-being, cognitive function, and health knowledge, and on top of that also provides a lot of physiological adaptations. And therefore it's a great pleasure for us to enroll this. So far we have reached 450 Danish schools, 30,000 participants, and also many of the Faroe schools promoted by my colleague Magni Moore. And it's very interesting for us to see that it's so popular also for some of the subject groups that we were not sure that we could reach with this program. But as you can see here, on a scale from 1 to 5, actually from 1 to 5, we see high scores, not only for boys that are usually playing football in a football club, but also for girls, also for ethnic minority girls, and even those that are not involved in leisure time sports. And we've also looked on using this program in the Danish Christmas seal homes. And as you can see, it's also perceived as a very popular activity. So they may not, some of these subject groups, like the type of football that you look on when you turn on the television, where it's very competitive, but they do like this program, which use modified exercises with football. So when we talk about the overall conclusions, I've already mentioned them, but they are for sure here. Football can be used for school children, for adults, for elderly, and for patients. And from a physiological point of view, it is a combination of three types of training, and it provides therefore broad spectrum cardiovascular effects, metabolic effects, and musculoskeletal effects. And I will skip this, just explaining why it is a very good broad spectrum training. But I would like to show you this model, because that incorporates also not only the sports science, not only the physiology, but also the sports medicine, and on top of that, the sports sociology and the sports psychology. So this is a holistic model on why football fitness and other types of recreational sports can be described as healthy, fun, and social, and why it can be used as prevention, treatment, and rehabilitation. Because what you need is recruitment, but what is even more important, that's adherence. And this model is also in this book. You may need just a few more minutes to understand the full concept. But there are also possibilities to look into this at the Sport and Health Sciences Research Group homepage, where we have made some overviews that are good for students and for colleagues so that they can look at the evidence behind each of the concepts. Yes, and I started out saying that we are in 22 countries with these concepts so far. The world map is up there. There's a lot of potential in this, and we are hoping for a further expansion. And for that, networking is extremely important. Partnership work with sporting organizations, with funding bodies, with municipalities, in some cases companies like the Novo Nordic in China, but certainly also international partners with the WHO and the EU and the big football governing bodies. So thanks a lot to all that have contributed. The last part of my presentation is about elite sports. Leading a very interesting research network in elite sports. It's called ProKit. In Danish, præstation, restitution og kostoptimering i intervallidræt. In English, performance, recovery and diet in intermittent sports. Focusing mainly on ice hockey, team handball, football and badminton. And today I will only focus on women's football. And why? Because I'm involved in women's football. We have published a lot of articles in women's football, but also because my research group is contributing to a special issue on women's football that will be released in just 2 months, with 16 scientific articles covering many of the aspects that have not been covered so far in elite football for women. So just a few highlights from those results. As you can see here, two very brand new articles coming out from the University of Norway, where Morten Randers is affiliated, and SDU, with one of the ProKit PhD students as first authors, Jeppe Panduro. We've looked at women's football for many years. Here you can see results from high intensity running during a football match, showing marked declines as an indicator of fatigue, both for those at the top level and those at the high level. Later on, we've been looking also at very intense peak periods, which has become more and more intense in modern women's football, and also what we call temporary fatigue. So after a very intense period comes a very low intensity period, and then, which is even lower than the average. And that occurs for all playing positions, except the goalkeeper. And what about the end of the game, which we call permanent fatigue? Yeah, for all playing positions, with high-speed running, very high-speed running, and sprints, we see a lowering towards the end of the game, even though that many matches are decided at the end of the game. And we know that from many studies that the fitness is very important for match performance. And that's also the case for women's football. These are results from the Danish Best League in 2005. I was a young researcher at that time. This shows data from the English Premier League when Magni and I were working in Exeter. We collected data from the best English league. And here we see that fatigue does occur. It's not only for tactical reasons that players perform less towards the end of the game, it's also because they're really fatigued. So if you want to perform better than Pernille Harder and Signe Bruun in a yo-yo test, you should make them do a yo-yo test against you right after a national team game, because then they're really fatigued. And we have conducted invasive studies, as I said in the beginning, also with female elite football players. And this was actually the first study where we collected biopsies during and after a game. Many of the SDU researchers were in Tricola in Greece. And if you're listening, thanks a lot, all my colleagues in Greece. We can see here that performance is declining. Sprint is much lower, much slower. After an intense period in the first half, after an intense period in the second half, but also after the game. And we can, to some extent, explain the finding of a lowering of sprint performance towards the end of the game, because we have a lowering of muscle glycogen. But still, all the players have some glycogen left, between 100 and some even 400 millimoles per kilogram per dry weight. But if we look at the individual fibers, the slow twitch fibers, so-called type 1 fibers, and the fast twitch fibers, the so-called type 2 fibers, the white fibers, then you see that there are no empty glycogen, empty fibers before the match, but there are more than 30% after the match, and another 50% are almost empty of glycogen. And that occurs both for the fast twitch fibers and the slow twitch fibers. So that's a part of the explanation of why sprinting cannot be performed optimally towards the end of the game. And from that same study, we also looked at how muscle morphology was related to performance. And as you can see here, we got indications that lactate transporters are related to the performance, the total match distance covered in the game. And over here, we got some sodium proton exchanges that are related to this total sprinting distance. And that's probably because repeated sprinting during a football game requires fast recovery. And here you see an indicator of muscle acidity. And that's actually related to the ability for the muscle to recover fast between sprints. And we know from this article, also in the special issue, that a lot of knowledge has not been gained. Even though we see a big rise in the studies related to football, in the studies related to male football, we see only a small increase in the number of scientific articles related to female elite football. But we can do better than that, and we are on our way with a lot of research. But some of the things that we haven't investigated is glycogen resynthesis for women after a game. We will do that soon. This has been done for men, and we can see that the fast twitch fibers are very slow in recovering after a game. And that's why it's really good that there are 3 or 4 days between matches in the big tournaments. And we have developed some protocols that can be used to investigate this, with standardized match-related activities for women. And if I had more time, I would dig a lot into how we can determine fiber type-specific recruitment. That can be done in many ways. And we can also look at how well the quadriceps muscle, the vastus lateralis of the quadriceps muscle, where we collect the muscle biopsies, actually represent the full quadriceps muscle. We've done that with the so-called muscle temperature methodology, or the thermal methodology. We've looked at creatine phosphate. This was a little bit nerdy when I studied 5,000 or 6,000 individual muscle fibers many years ago. But it actually provided some interesting results related to how training can recruit and train specifically type 2 fibers. And we've done a lot of studies with that. And we can actually see that type 2 fibers are very different from type 1 fibers. They have if we make a partial neuromuscular blockade of the type 1 fibers, then you use the type 2 fibers. And then you can see that the oxygen cost is much higher and the efficiency is much lower. And if anybody are interested in that, you should look at this model that I made many years ago. I'm not promoting that as heavily as the football is medicine model, but it actually took as long to create this model compared to the others. Okay, what about training? That's my last point. We can do very high intensity training where we do not see an effect during low intensity exercise, but only during high intensity exercise. And football has elements of high intensity that are often very important. That's why we know now that we can increase glycogen content quite a lot if we train very intensely. We can increase peak lactate release. We can increase sodium potassium pump, the number of sodium potassium pumps. And that will all affect the intensity of work during a football game. And my colleague Maggie Moore and I have done many training studies to compare different types of training. In this particular study, we compared strength training and speed endurance training. We saw that there were positive effects of both, but in terms of fatigue index, the ability to recover, speed endurance training was much better. And after that, we looked at different types of speed endurance training, and we saw that speed endurance production training was even better than the speed endurance maintenance training. I hope I lost you there. And sometimes many practices can be done with a ball in small-sided settings, but some types of training have better results if you do it as specific drills, focusing on the physiological adaptations. And here are some results of very effective high-intensity training conducted with the Danish national team before a big tournament. And as you can see here, the yo-yo intermittent performance increased quite a lot. And we performed really well during this tournament, not only the first game, but throughout the tournament. And we did a lot of things because the coach was really interested in using all the knowledge that were available. And therefore, we managed to improve performance in many ways. And this video will not be shown today because I'm running out of time. But that's a video that explains how that was done for the starting 11 with Pernille Harder and other top class players. She's the most expensive player in the world, you know that. But also the substitutes, which were very important towards the end of the tournament. So we trained them after games and made sure that they could perform throughout the tournament. And with that, I would like to thank you all for listening.
Thank you, Peter, for a very interesting talk. And I would like to open the floor for questions, and maybe if there are some also. Yeah. Shamsu first.
Thank you, Peter. It's a very exciting talk. I can see that a football game can or training can definitely improve the quality of life. And do you have any statistical data that football training can also improve the lifespan?
We do not have that yet, but based on some cross-sectional data, we do see that, for example, telomere length and telomerase activity is of a higher level for those that have been physically active with football and other sports throughout their life. So that may indicate that you can actually delay senescence. But we are really interested in collaborating to do long-term studies, long-term training studies that can see whether we can actually increase the number of living years. But without doubt, we can increase the number of living years without disease, which may also be an indicator of the total lifespan.
Super inspiring talk. I might also want to start playing something like in my end. Yes. So I was wondering, you talk about the importance of the glycogen stores and refilling them. Have you looked into the importance of lipid stores in muscles and in between the muscle fibers?
I haven't, but that would be of great interest to expand our research further in that direction. Yeah. And maybe you can help out.
Maybe. Could you use the microphone because we have people online?
I can just comment that we are doing that at the moment, analytically speaking, but we haven't got any results yet.
There are also some data that some lipid droplets are actually associated with the mitochondria, and so maybe there is that direct transport from the lipid droplets to the mitochondria. I think it's a super exciting field.
For sure, and I mean, we can see that mitochondrial function is elevated quite a lot with football training for untrained adults and also for elderly. We can see that the oxidative enzyme activity, both in relation to glycogen oxidation, glycose oxidation, but also fat oxidation, increases quite a lot. And we can see that, for example, if we count the number of capillaries around each muscle fiber type, we see increases in local blood perfusion to type 1 and type 2 fibers after just 12 weeks of football fitness training. So that indicates that there's a broad spectrum metabolic fitness component. And this can be explored further with new technologies, and we would be really interested in collaborating on that.
Okay, thanks, Peter. That was really interesting. And it's a bit sad that watching football doesn't give you the same effects, but that aside. So I got one question, because you had some comparisons between football and running and jogging, and one more, I forgot.
Strength training.
And obviously that you showed that, so this kind of exercise has all these benefits. But is this specific to football, or does that go for all team sports? Or would you say that football is the most healthy exercise form?
Let me just start by saying I'm also pretty sad that watching football is not giving the same benefits, because 2.5 billion people are watching the World Cup and only 500 million are playing football regularly. Now I say only 500 million, it's still pretty good, but we would be interested in reaching many more. So that may explain why football is so interesting as a model, because it's so popular. And it's really easy to transfer knowledge regarding football. But you can say that football is certainly a broad-spectrum effective training type that combines the three different types of training. But that can be done in many other ways. And we are looking into the use of team handball, for example, as prevention and as treatment of lifestyle diseases. And overall, we have very positive results for team handball. The same would certainly be the case for basketball and floorball and ice hockey, all the intermittent sports that combine the three elements. As I said in the beginning, you can also get this optimal training by combining different types of training. And all my colleagues are covering different types of sports, and there's a lot of scope and a lot of sports. So is football the healthiest sport? No, we don't know whether it is, but it's certainly very healthy, and it can be used, and it's easy and accessible for many. So we can say that it's a great sport, but sport as such has a huge potential, and we have to explore that further to get those 2.5 million TV viewers actually to be physically active themselves. Did I say million or billion? I meant billion.
Thank you for a brilliant talk, Peter. I have a follow-up question, I think, in terms of what Sunu was asking. Would there be any detrimental effects? Have you looked at that in terms of motivation for other sports, given your results? I'm sitting here, I don't play football, I don't want to play football, I swim and I cycle, but now I'm thinking, well, maybe I just should stop it, because if I have to get all the good effects by combining so much more, then maybe it's not worth it. And so I'm wondering, have you looked into side effects of that, of the negative kind of your results?
No. Short and brief answer. No, I mean, we are, as you can see in the Fit First and Fit First, in the Fit First 10 and the Fit First 20, we are really interested in using football as one model, and that this model can be expanded to many, many other sports. And actually, we've been conducting ways to ensure high intensity and to ensure a combination of high heart rates and high impact of all the sports. It's just a matter of using your knowledge from sports science. Then you can actually make any sport having elements of high impact. So when we're talking about sports, we are often a bit traditional. It has to be in the same way that the big sporting organizations organize the sport and that they broadcast in the World Cup and on the telly. And any type of sport can actually be modified to include social elements, to include high intensity. So I think that you may look at your own sports and modify it a little bit. So if you go cycling, you have to do some uphill cycling and downhill cycling. And then you would optimally have to combine that with, because cycling is not weight bearing, then you would have to combine that with either team handball or some strength training to get the optimal effects. But still, your cycling in itself is it's hugely recommendable because it gives you a very good high intensity training and a very good endurance training. It promotes heart health and metabolic health. And then you have to add the musculoskeletal health and the balance in some other manner.
Okay, I won't give up.
Sounds good.
Anthony first.
Thank you, Peter. So, as someone who doesn't really know anything about football, I think it's easy enough to see how it's both endurance training and high intensity training, but I'm not understanding which part of it is strength training.
I should probably have shown you those results anyway. Maybe I'll go back then. Not fast enough. That's it. Okay, why is it strength training? It's certainly because when you look at just a normal training session for women that have never played football before, there are almost 100 high intensity runs in just 1 hour of playing football. And there are more than 50 backwards runs. So you use a lot of muscles in a different manner. That's one thing. And many of them are intense, much more intense than if you walk to get the bus. The sprints and the stops are important, and the variation in movements. Then secondly, when we count, we see a lot of direction changes. We see a lot of ball handling, with dribbles and shots. And we see, in some cases, also jumps, although not in football fitness, because they never jump. You know why? Because the ball is never up in the air. So why jump? But still they have, as you can see here, tackles, they have stops, they have direction changes, and that provides a broad spectrum stimuli to the muscles and the bones. And last but not least, over here you can see some high quality data on accelerations and decelerations. And actually, on the x-axis, you got the total number of decelerations during a FC prostate training session with 70-year-old men playing against each other, 5 versus 5. And then the increases in bone mineral content after 12 weeks of training. And you can see the more decelerations, the better effects. So that's the reason why it's strength training, because it has the impact both when you touch the ground, but also when the muscles are pulling for the kicking and the sprinting.
Nikos, and then the last question here.
Thanks, Peter. Very interesting presentation. I was thinking from an implementation science perspective, I was wondering whether you experienced some challenges that myself and others in Australia experienced when we tried to implement sport in community settings. The challenges have to do with the finances, and I'm curious how similar or not the situation is in Denmark. So sport clubs will not deliver these programs for free, they will ask for a fee, perhaps $15-$20 per session, and immediately the funders say this is not sustainable because these programs only appeal to people who can afford them. The question is, how are these programs are sustainable long-term in Denmark? Who pays for them?
It depends on which program. The programs for patients are usually paid for, firstly by funding bodies or charities, and later on by the municipalities. But for untrained individuals performing training that that are related to prevention, it's often covered by the football clubs themselves and the players themselves. So so there's a very, very strong network of sporting clubs in Denmark, more than 1,650 football clubs and 800 team handball clubs, which doesn't sound as much, but it's a small country. So there's basically a football club and a team handball club in every single city. And there are a lot of unpaid coaches that actually turn up free willingly to conduct training. And that's much of the expansion of this has been run by the football club. We are supporting the Danish FA and the Danish Sports Confederation and SDU are supporting this by providing the coaching courses, but we are actually not supporting the training itself. It's covered by the clubs and the players, which makes it actually very sustainable. But for a further expansion, we would be interested in aiming at a model at the governmental level or the municipality level that could support the patient groups even more than they do today.
That's very interesting. That wouldn't happen in Western Australia. Clubs wouldn't give the facilities for free, so that's very good.
Okay. This is a question for Peter and Magni Moore. And you know that I am using football fitness to train my sport, mountain running and trail, which is the most popular sport in Switzerland where I'm living. And I had a great improvement, both in tests and both in the performance in competition. And I was trying to understand why. Is it biomechanical effects? Is a cardiac effects or something inside my muscle fiber has happened? I don't know. We investigated my heart and my heart has greatly improved the performance, but we don't know nothing about muscle. What do you think, you or Magni or Morten?
I think that it's really interesting to look at any type of sporting activity as a combination of training types. And that can lead us to understand why football players actually have to add strength training to their football training if they are at elite level, because then Pernille Harder and Signe Bruun need something extra to jump those additional 5 centimeters that they do not get from the football itself. Likewise, if you treat a patient or if you are an ultra marathon runner, then you have to look at the specific different types of effects. And certainly the football gives you more strength, explosive strength, and gives you also a higher intensity of the anaerobic training, including the involvement of type 2 fibers. So that may actually help you in the large phases where other fibers are completely emptied of glycogen.
Thank you very much, Peter. In the interest of time, I think we would like to thank you also for answering the questions. Should we give a hand to Peter?
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And we have a lecture also next week where we will have visitors from Copenhagen University and they will talk about some physics. So I hope to see you there again.
And don't forget your Christmas present.